Greenwich Hospital, which is affiliated with Yale New Haven and Lawrence Memorial, they got hit very hard because they're at the border of New York, and their whole entire hospital was COVID except for like a very small designated non-COVID unit. I remember talking like, oh, you know, I wish we could do something. And then the next day we get a phone call, hey, will anyone go up to Greenwich to help out? And my unit, there was a bunch of us that were like, well, we'll go. We get there, and it was definitely an eye-opening experience because, you know, every single patient has COVID, and patients that really should be in ICU are in regular medical beds because there's just not enough critical care beds. People are on immense amounts of oxygen. I mean, I've been a nurse for 19 years, and I've never seen people on, like, requiring this much oxygen ever in my entire life. So I went back home because our numbers started to go up. One of my coworkers that I worked with since, I mean, I was in high school, I worked with her. I remember she even said, she's like, I just have a stomach bug, something, you know, I'm fine, I'm okay. I'm like, no, I think you should, you know, you need to go home and, you know, get tested. And she ended up going home. But then she came back to work because she felt fine. Like, she really thought it was a stomach thing. It was just, that was like a little bizarre. But next thing we know that she's out again and she's home. And as far as we know, she said she was doing better. But then people are like, no, she's not doing better. And then after talking to her husband, he said that she finally said, okay, you know, I need to go to the hospital. And he said by the time paramedics got there, you know, her oxygen level was like in the I think he said like 40s or 50s. And I know Elva very well. And I know that she is an amazing PCA, patient care assistant, but she's also strong-headed and very stubborn, and she's going to do things her way. And I think that that was her way, you know. And thank God, and knock on wood, that no one else, we haven't had to experience anything else like that, but that was hard. Like, for our unit, because we've all worked together for a really long time, we're all like family. Like, we work the same weekend, the same holidays for decades, really. And, you know, and it's sometimes it still doesn't necessarily feel real. And I think it's because we're still in the mix of it all. But there's times where it's just like, if we start talking about it, it will start hitting home. With Elva, she was born to be a patient care assistant. That was her heart and soul. When she trained somebody, she was going to train them the right way. If you could have a picture of somebody that is your ideal nurse's assistant, I see Elva's face because she is just that person that did everything perfectly. You know, the numbers just kept going up and up and up. And the stories, patient stories were just like horrible. You see families completely obliterated, or, you know, one room, the mother passes away, and the next room you have the son who has to now find out that his mom just passed away, you know, but he's still trying to recover, you know, like that. And that's, you know, gut wrench. That's just, those stories are just crazy. But then you also have some positive stories. You know, it's like, you know, I had a couple that they were in their 90s and they were together forever and they were in the hospital for a while. And, you know, a couple that you wouldn't think would make it, but they did. You know, we discharge them both the same day home and they're fine, you know. But then you see a lot of husbands and wives that they both ended up passing away. But, you know, we had one cute couple, they were, I think, 93, 94. And I want to say they both passed away within like 4 hours of apart. And in some ways, it's like they were ready to die. I think they knew, like, they were mentally ready. They were ready. And I think there was something special about them, like, being there in the same room together. It's just something odd and special about that time. The sad thing is just the family not being able to be there, you know. That's hard. In the beginning of COVID, the patients that were dying, a lot of them were older, but we would walk into these rooms and these people would just be covered in thick, brown, nasty secretions, like they like vomited or suffocated in their own, like, stuff that we normally would like run in there and like suction them or whatever, like, or with COVID pneumonia, like, the mucus is so thick, thicker than I've ever seen before in my life, and it's like, that's just what they're suffering, like, they're just drowning. And so, like, that I've seen people die and all the time. But like, to walk into these rooms and just be like, I wish I was there, or somebody was there. These things were just like not normal. Like, people's respirations were in the 50s, and they normally should be, what, 16 to 20. Like, just breathing wise, it was just horrible. At Greenwich, I was not expecting to take care of the patients that I did take care of. So there was a huge Hispanic, Latino population that I cared for, that, and they were so horribly affected. Like, people in their 30s that normally should be totally fine, and they're on a boatload of oxygen and there for weeks. And I think that part at Greenwich shocked me the most, and also my heart just hurt for them, because I'm like, well, that could be me, but also they have a hard time communicating what they need. And you could just see the despair, or like the anxiety in their eyes. Like, you could just tell that they were fearful, because they don't know what to expect. I had one kid, he was in his 20s, and he was Hispanic, and he was there for the 3 weeks, and he's like fit, healthy, and he had the crazy temps of like 105, 106, and you know, he was on oxygen, and he's like, Chris, I'm so afraid that I am going to be intubated. He's like, I'm so afraid that I'm going to, one day it's going to get worse. And because at that time it was weird that we knew, like, at that point it seemed like around the day 10 part, people either made a turn for the better or they made a turn for the worst. And it was just kind of a weird thing that we just saw there, and he knew it. And I think I felt more like, I wish there was more I could do for these people, I think, other than more treat symptoms. It's like, we couldn't really cure people. We're just trying to prevent you from getting intubated and dying.